Daddy. It doesn't matter who my father was. It matters who I remember he was. People will often build their views of God based on how they view their earthly fathers. But are earthly fathers a good picture of your heavenly father? It depends. For some, father brings up feelings of comfort and security. Yet for others, just imagining the sound of your father's footsteps raises an instinct to try to hide. You might look back at your father and think, if God's anything like my old man, I don't want to have anything to do with him. So when we talk about God the Father, our minds, not our emotions, must dominate. We need to let God's word, not our feelings or earthly experiences, be our guide when we try to figure out what we mean by God the Father. Throughout the Bible, we find the perfect picture of a perfect father. Moses' request in Exodus was a sincere one. If you are pleased with me, teach me your ways so I may know you and continue to find favor with you. In the passages following this request, God reveals no less than 14 fatherly traits about himself, each of which is amplified in many other places throughout the Bible. These traits also make a decent model for those of us who are fathers on earth, but they are not intended to be a guilt trip to try to make us perform better. Instead, they should encourage us all as father's kids with the wonderful news of our perfect parent who cherishes, values, and adores us. Father, I pray that any misconceptions I have about you will be swept away by the truth of your word. I want to know you and I want to learn about you in a relation way that is free from misleading emotions. Please help me clear my mind so your spirit can lead me to the truth. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. The present of presents. My father, I never knew him, never even seen a picture of him. The first fatherly trait in Exodus is one of the most important for any sort of relationship. He is around. The Lord replied, "My presence will go with you." When Moses asked who would go with him, God said, "I will go with you." We find this all throughout the scripture. Wherever you go, God will be there. Amen. My dad traveled a lot when I was young. When we were living in England, Dad would sometimes be in the States for months at a time. We miss him terribly. One of the reasons we moved to Milwaukee in 1970 was so that my father could be more invested in our lives, so he could be around more. During the years of his absence, my mom pointed me to the fatherness of God. She taught me that he is always around, no matter where I am or what I am doing. While Dad was gone, I was forced to see God's fatherness in my life, and his presence became a reality to me. God is with you right now, even as you read these words, intricately involved in your individual life as a very present Father. No mountain is too high, no valley too low, no river too wide to keep him away from you. You might even try to run away from God, to turn your back on him. But the moment you stop, you will realize that he is still there with you. I mean, look what happened to Jonah. Consider this. The Lord your God is with you, the mighty warrior who saves. He will take great delight in you, in his love. He will no longer rebuke you, but will rejoice you with singing. Not only in God with you, but he enjoys being with you. He desires to love you in every way possible. God, thank you for your constant presence. Thank you for loving me enough to never abandon me. Please help me remember that you are with me all the time. Amen. The ultimate release. You have made us for yourself, O Lord, and our hearts are restless until they rest in you. Life is a struggle. Anybody will tell you that. No matter where we end up, we will wrestle with problems, be they financial, emotional, physical, or a host of other difficulties. As many as there are, so are there more tactics to deal with them. Fathers of Earth will have millions of different solutions, be it to let them sort out themselves or to slam your nose to the grindstone until there is nothing left. Unlike either of those stances, our Heavenly Father tells us one thing that encompasses any problem we might face, and I will give you rest. God will give us rest. Some of us had fathers who pushed and pushed us to the brink of mental and physical exhaustion. God the Father is different. He comforts us. Yes, he has things for you to do, and those things are very important. But Scripture makes it clear that those things are done by depending on God's strength working through us, rather than by us using our strength to try to do things for him. It was I, God, who taught Ephraim to walk, taking them by the arms, but they did not realize it was I who healed them. I led them with cords of humankind, with ties of love. To them I was like one who lifts a little child to the cheek, and I bent down to feed them. In this passage from Hosea, we see that God not only takes our burdens, but he wants to take them because of his unending love for us. There is no limit to what he is able to handle, nor to what he will do for you. That brings up a pretty deep question. What have you been struggling? Sorry. What have you been struggling with in your own strength, rather than trusting it to the Father who loves you? Father, take the burdens I have placed on myself. I cannot tackle these things on my own. I release what I have been trying to do myself to you. I give up trying on my own. I trust in your strength so I may constantly rest in your comfort. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. You are set apart. Could we change our attitude? We should not only see life differently, but life itself would come to be different. I did a chapel for the Milwaukee Brewers a number of years ago. That was a big deal. Where I used to live, the Brewers were the gods of bat, ball, and diamond. Every devote Wisconsinite watched them on TV. Those who could afford tickets would regularly make the pilgrimage to County Stadium to worship in person. But to enter into the locker room that was the Holy of Holies, the inner sanctuary of the temple where no more mortal fan would ever think of gaining access. But I had an in. Paul Molitor. Paul was the captain of the team of, and because I knew him, I was welcome at the lockers. I was even allowed to speak to the players face to face. I shared with a whole group through whole group thoughts from the Bible, and they listened. All because of Paul, he elevated me to a different level in the eyes of these amazing athletes. They were willing to listen to me because of my relationship with him. Here's a similar situation with God and the Israelites. Then Moses said to him, "How will anyone know that you are pleased with me and with your people unless you go with us?" What else will distinguish me and your people from all the other people on the face of the earth? God the Father does the same thing for us. His presence in our lives separates us from others. He distinguishes us. Some may not recognize God as being the source of our uniqueness, but He is. When we become aware of our position as God's children, we start to project that in our behavior and attitude. We become elevated, changed, unique in the world. And many will be willing to listen to us as we make Him known as a natural extension of that relationship with the Father. Father, I pray that you would elevate my lifestyle in such a way that I am obviously different from the world. Let me be an example of what life is like in you so that others may know your awesomeness. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Your perfect provision now. If God owns everything and knows everything, if He loves us and is perfect and holy in all He does, then everything He gives and everything He withholds can rightly be recognized as a good gift from Him, even if we are unable to see it as such. Sometimes people put unreasonable expectations on God. They expect things He never promised and then get frustrated when they don't have them right now. But God doesn't give us everything that we want. He gives us what we need. Moses was aware of the great need he and the Israelites had for God's presence. It wasn't just a desire, it was a necessity. Then Moses said to him, "How will anyone know that you are pleased with me and with your people unless you go with us? What else will distinguish me and your people from all the other people on the face of the earth?" And the Lord said to Moses, "I will do the very thing you have asked." God knew that Moses' request reflected a real need for their mission, His presence. So God said He would do it, and He provided for their need because He is a perfect provider. God owns everything. God is generous. God is aware of our needs. Therefore, we not only ask God for what we hope He will provide, but we can be confident He is providing the very things we need right now. If this is true, shouldn't our prayers be focused on aligning our desires with what God clearly says that we need? Can you tell the difference between your desires and what a loving Father knows that you need? Do you believe God is providing for you right now everything that you truly need, just as He will provide for you in the future? God, thank you that you are providing everything I need today. Make the difference between what I want and what I need very clear. Amen. The God paradox. My deepest awareness of myself is that I am deeply loved by Jesus Christ and I have done nothing to earn it or deserve it. Maybe it was through art, maybe through fiery, angry sermons. I don't know where for sure, but somewhere along the line, many of us got the idea that God the Father is angry and He is sitting up in heaven on a cloud, deep in score, all the time. He has a list of laws and rules in one hand and a lightning bolt in the other. He is just waiting for you to screw up, and when you do, is that accurate? Not even close. Look at what God told Moses when he requested God's presence. "I will do the things you have asked because I am pleased with you." God is pleased with us. God told Moses that He would be present among them because He was pleased with him. Now you might say, "Yeah, that's because it's Moses. I am no Moses." Moses is supposed to be this great godly leader, right? Well, he's supposed to be, but he's not. Do you know what happened right before this passage? Moses' followers built a huge golden cow and worshipped it instead of God. If Moses was supposed to be some great leader, shouldn't his followers like maybe follow? But in reality, his people were a mess, just like we are. just like you are, but still God finds pleasure in us in spite of poor performance. Hallelujah. Lord, it is so hard to understand that even though humanity is broken, you still love us, even in the worst of times. Thank you for finding pleasure in me in Christ, where the world only sees failure. Hallelujah. Amen. The God who hears you, always respond to every impulse to pray. The impulse to pray may come when you are reading or when you are battling with a text. I would make an absolute law of this. Always obey such an impulse. How important would you feel if your father had 3 billion kids' phone numbers in his iPhone and you were just one of them? How much attention could one man give that many children? Virtually none. But our Heavenly Father has no limitation on His power, His knowledge, or His ability to be everywhere for everyone all at once. This was made clear in His talk with Moses when He said, "I am pleased with you and I know you by name." Years ago, I was sitting with thousands of college students at the Urbana Conference at Illinois University. The arena was packed to the rafters. At one point in the program, they asked all 20,000 of us to pray out loud. I was overwhelmed not just by the noise or the cumulative effect, but by the simple fact that God was capable of hearing each prayer and answering it perfectly. For God the Father, every prayer we pray is the only one He hears. There is no such thing as background prayers. Why? Because He is interested. Are not 5 sparrows sold for your pennies, yet not one of them is forgotten by God? Indeed, the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Don't be afraid, you are worth more than many sparrows. God knows your name and it's always on His heart. If you have a thorn in your foot, you cares about it, even though there may be floods and famine elsewhere on the planet. He can give you 100% of His attention and not have any less for anyone else. That's your significance in God's eyes. I am thankful that you are listening to this prayer and can give your 100% attention to me. Thank you for being interested in me, for caring for me, for loving me.